to us above all power.
Knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. This, of course, was thinking back to Psalm, we would believe, verse 21, where he says, they gave me vinegar for my thirst. A psalm written of David, but really prophetic of the life of Jesus to come. The one word of these seven that I think Jesus spoke was this one about himself. The others were all about other people, about his family, about those that had sinned against him. But this one was about himself. The one word he spoke for himself. And you know, before the nails were pounded, he was taken to Golgotha, to Calvary, as a common thief, and placed between two thieves. And they were, the practice of the day was to offer thieves in those days a drink, a sedative, that would deaden the pain and lessen the trauma. And you know what? He actually refused to drink that drink. Think about this. Jesus, 12 hours before, was actually taken captive, and he'd been scourged and abused and cursed, and he'd dragged across through the streets. This man was thirsty. This was a man, because you know, when we as Christians, we fully believe that Jesus was fully God and fully man. You must understand that. Fully God and fully man. This is Jesus, the Son of God. God himself, the Bible clearly says, was on the cross. And so, consider this, he refused to take that drink. But now, some hours later, and as Max Lucado says, lips cracked and a mouth of cotton, a throat so dry he could not swallow, and a voice so hoarse he could not speak. Since the Last Supper, 12 hours before, when he would have drunk food for the last time with his disciples, he'd been beaten, spat upon, bruised, cut and scourged. He'd been a cross carrier and a sin bearer, and no liquid. He is thirsty. And there, I say, he should be. Here we have, instead of our faith, we have a suffering God. People say, where is God in the earthquake? Suffering with us. Suffering with us. Suffer. We serve a suffering God and a merciful God. Because God's suffering and God's mercy go hand in hand. And you know, why was Jesus, why did he choose to do this? And why did he say, I thirst? Well, it was because he wanted to show us his humanity. He wanted to show us that he wasn't in some ethereal state. He was a man like you and I. But he was fully God. And so he wanted to show us his humanity. He wanted to complete the task before him. He went to the cross confident, as it says, knowing that all things have been accomplished and the scripture should be fulfilled. As has been said before, he gave himself up to crucifixion. And why did Jesus proclaim his thirst? To lay one more plank on a sturdy bridge of faith over which we as believers can confidently. The Christian faith gives us confidence in life, in our future, in our God. Jesus says, you can trust in me. I am that person that will never leave you or forsake you, because I've become like you. I've tasted death for you. I've been thirsty for you. To close, Hebrews 4, verse 15-16 says, he understands every weakness of ours, because he was tempted in every way, but he did not sin. So whenever we are in need, we should come bravely before the throne of our merciful God. Then we'll be treated with understanding, undeserved kindness, and we will find help in our time of need. So God bless you this Easter, as we share a confident faith together, as we serve a God who would be where we're at today. Thank you so much.
Until
James Emery White tells him of his most difficult pastoral situation. A parishioner called him and said the wife of his next door neighbour had just committed suicide. She was the mother of five girls. Her youngest daughter had found her. He said, "Would you come?" He said, "When I arrived, I saw the five daughters and their father huddled in a corner of the house. I thought to myself, what can I possibly say? What can I do that will help at this moment?" I went over to the family and introduced myself and said the only words that I can think of, "I just want you to know that I'm sorry. I'm so very, very sorry." The girl who had found her mother looked up at me and said, "Would you pray for us?" So I prayed. "I don't remember a single word of that prayer," he said. "But when I finished, that little girl looked up at me and simply said, 'God's here, isn't he?'" And I said, "Yes, he is." She said, "I thought so. I could feel him hugging me when you pray. It's going to be all right, isn't it?" And I said, "Yes, honey, it's going to be hard, but it's going to be all right. God's here, isn't he?" That poor little girl's words could easily be dismissed as wishful thinking of a tragic situation, and the pastor's agreeing with her could be viewed as just a reassuring word of comfort. Suffering is terrible. It's inexplicable. When we suffer like this, sometimes it seems like God has taken a holiday. But the Bible supports this little girl's view. God is here in hurts. In Matthew we read, "From noon until 3 PM, darkness came over the land. About 3 PM, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?'" You can imagine the strange, eerie feeling. It's the middle of the day and it's dark. And for 3 hours, the strange darkness is upon the land. Everyone would be asking, "What's happening? What's going on?" The Jews knew their scriptures, and their own prophets they recorded these words in Amos. "In that day, declares the sovereign Lord, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will make that time like morning for an only sun." A cosmic drama was being played out here. He who had never known sin was made sin. Jesus, who had had such closeness with the Father, who could say such things as, "The Father and I are one, and I am in him, and he is in me." And here he was experiencing a breach in that relationship with his heavenly Father. When the sin of the world was placed on Jesus, the holiness of God meant God had to turn his back. Fellowship was broken. How could a holy God commune with sin? And there Jesus was bearing your sin and mine and the sin of the whole world. And God looked away, turned his back, resulting in Jesus bearing God's anger and judgment upon sin. And a part of that judgment was isolation, abandonment, dereliction, darkness. And in addition, all the demons of hell were able to capitalize on the opportunity and jump on Jesus' shoulders and torment him. A few hours earlier, Jesus had said, "This is the hour when darkness reigns." And so here, as the sin of the world comes upon Jesus and fellowship with his God is broken, there's darkness. And in the midst of this darkness comes this penetrating cry, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Just as out of the original darkness in Genesis 1, God brought this wonderful, glorious creation. Just out of the plague of darkness in Egypt, God brought a new nation. So also out of this darkness, God would again bring something new, something beautiful, a new humanity, a resurrection. The first fruits of a new creation. I don't know what darkness you're facing today, but here is the unique thing about the Christian faith when it comes to suffering. God came down and suffered also in Christ. He joins us in our suffering. God didn't just turn his back on it all and ignore it. And we may shake our fist at God and we may complain in our anger and confusion. We may ask the big question, why? But the one thing we can declare is that God came down and entered into this world and he suffered horrifically on the cross. That means we can come to him in our time of need and know that he identifies with our pain. He feels it too. It wasn't what he intended for this world. And because Jesus was raised from the dead, he can bring this transforming power to bear on our suffering, so that in the end, we will one day look back and say, thank you, that you think that our power is worth the pain. At the very time when God seemed furthest from him, Jesus was actually the very center of his will. And because Jesus was forsaken and abandoned, you and I can know his acceptance and his loving presence in our own time without us.
Before